Good afternoon, everyone. I'll be presenting today on a patient that we had in the ICU, and I've titled my presentation as a thoughtful analysis. So this is a 47-year-old male with no known comorbidities who on January 15 started developing high-grade intermittent fever with chills. On Jan 17, he was taken to an outside hospital where he was noted to have a depressed sensorium. He wasn't answering very much to the questions of the relatives much. He was mostly not talking a lot. His verbal output was reduced. So he was given antibiotics in the center, following which he became agitated. And on January 19th, he was referred to CMC for further evaluation because in the outside hospital, they couldn't come to a diagnosis. And he was referred here to CMC from the SARI ward. He was referred back to the C ward. And he was at that point of time noticed to have difficulty in swallowing solids by the next day. So on January 20th, 3:30 p.m., he noted that the relative actually noticed that he was having some grimacing of the face. He was able to answer and he was responsive to commands during this point of time, and this lasted for around 5 minutes, and it was responsive to midazolam. So anti-seizure medications were added slowly, and on January 20th at 7:30 p.m. Grimacing was noted again with normal sensorium for 5 minutes again, and this again responded to the midaz. And January 21st, again, by the next day, he started having left upper limb tonic-clonic movements along with the grimacing. And he was shifted to ICU for general anesthesia for terminating these episodes of seizures. So on examination, when he had come, he was conscious and oriented. And his BP was 90 by 60 with a pulse of 72 per minute. Respiratory rate was 20 per minute, saturating at 98% in room air. His general examination was unremarkable. And on central nervous system examination, cranial nerves were normal. Motor system examination was also normal. There were no sensory deficits that were noted, no cerebellar signs. However, neck stiffness was present, but no Koenig's or Brutzensee sign. Other system examination was unremarkable. So the diagnosis that were considered at this point of time, the differential diagnosis that we had in mind was diagnosis of an acute meningoencephalitis. And the etiologies that we actually considered were infectious causes like viral scrub, dengue, spotted fever, HSV, enterovirus, partially treated bacterial meningitis because he had received antibiotics outside, parasitic being malaria, focal etiologies like brain abscess or tumor in view of the fact that he had focal seizure, left upper limb tonic-clonic movements, acute disseminated encephalomyelitis, and a paraneoplastic autoimmune encephalitis. So his course, he was shifted to ICU in view of refractory seizures, and he was started on thiopentone anesthesia. He was found to have seizures on the anesthetic agent as well. And then we labeled him as super refractory status epilepticus. So the relevant investigations, what I'd like you to focus on is actually only on that valproate assay that is there. So on 27-1, his valproate assay was 30.1 mics per milliliter. And on the MRI that was done, it just showed some hyperintensities in the right frontal region and in the left caudate nucleus. In this setting, it was representing more of a meningoencephalitis. Then what had happened was because he wasn't responding well and he was still getting seizures on the anesthetic agent, we reviewed his drugs. So there was paracetamol, acyclovir, doxycycline, ceftriaxone, dexamethasone, phenytoin, levetiracetam, lacosamide, thiopentone sodium, and sodium valproate. And on 28-1-21 in the ICU, meropenem was added after stopping other antibiotics in view of an Acinetobacter baumannii that had grown in the ET culture. So on 29-1-21, we repeated a valproate assay, which from 30 had now come down to 10 mics per ml, less than 10 mics per ml, in fact. So few things about valproate. So therapeutic valproate concentrations are between 50 to 100 micrograms per milliliter. I'm sorry for the typo. It's metabolized mainly in the liver by glucuronic acid conjugation and beta omega oxidation producing multiple metabolites. And less than 3% is excreted unchanged in the urine. So I looked at case reports wherein they were talking regarding valproic acid and carbapenem interaction. So this was a retrospective observational study that was published, and it actually looked at 6 patients who were critically ill patients on valproate acid who was receiving carbapenem, Meropenem, the numbers which are receiving meropenem were 4, imipenem was 1, and ertapenem was 1. And they compared this with the values when they were not taking meropenem, the valproic acid levels, and they were not taking meropenem. So then they found that the mean plasma trough VPA levels had dropped from 51.7 to 21.8 with a p-value which was significant of 0.025. So then I wanted to see how carbapenem actually causes this, what is the basis of the interaction between carbapenem and valproate. So this was a review article that I had found, which was published in the Annals of Pharmacotherapy in 2009 in December. So this had found that there were multiple mechanisms that were found in different studies. One is that it inhibits the intestinal transporter of valproic acid and inhibits absorption thus. Another finding is that it even inhibits the enterohepatic recycling of valproic acid, because the activity of the gut flora while the patient is on meropenem is reduced. And so beta-glucuronidase does not break down the glucuronidated valproic acid. Hence, it does not get recycled, and there is increased erythrocyte distribution of valproate, as whole blood concentrations of valproate did not fall significantly. So there are multidrug resistant proteins on the ATP binding acid transporters on the RBC membrane, which are inhibited by carbapenem, because of which it does not go into the serum. Hence, there is an increased erythrocyte distribution of valproate. So other theory is that the carbapenem may enhance glucuronidation of valproate by increasing the UDP glucuronic acid levels. So now coming to, there are certain case reports which use this mechanism and try to treat valproic acid toxicity with meropenem or any other carbapenem. So this was one such case report which was published in 2018 in the Journal of Clinical Pharmacy and Therapeutics. So this case report actually describes an intubated unresponsive patient after toxic valproic acid ingestion. So meropenem was prescribed for his pneumonia. However, they found that there was a 56% decline in the half-life of valproate that was observed, and his sensorium improved shortly after administration of the meropenem. So the learning points in my in this case was basically, I did not know that carbapenem and valproate, when they are given together, it can actually induce seizures and it can bring down the valproate levels to undetectable levels. So, and I also realized that there is the importance of reviewing drug charts and an analysis of drug interactions that could possibly impede appropriate therapy for the patient. Thank you.
Thank you, Shreya. I was not aware that carbapenems could negatively influence the serum levels of other drugs. First of all, beta-lactams drug interactions are extremely rare. If at all you have a drug like which can inhibit the renal secretion, tubular secretion, it can increase the levels and potentiate the toxicity of beta-lactam. But beta-lactams influencing other drugs is extremely rare. First time I'm hearing about interesting observation. What happened to your patient?
So he's still in ICU. He's on thiopentrone anesthesia still. Autoimmune encephalitis panel is negative. Viral PCR is also negative. So we still don't have a diagnosis on our patient. But he stopped to seize actually. From 6th onwards, he's not been having seizures. And his valproate levels are also coming up.
One more comment. Using a carbapenem to treat Acinetobacter baumannii VAP in our ICU, was the isolate susceptible to?
It was susceptible actually. Wow. It was a pan-susceptible organism.
Pan-susceptible Acinetobacter baumannii. We should celebrate. Thank you. Other question? Karthik, any additional comments?
Sir, nothing much, sir. We just want to emphasize on the fact that when patients on multiple drugs, to look for interactions. This patient, unfortunately, we still don't have a diagnosis for him. The valproate is a very small part of his the thing, but he is on supranormal dose of thiopentone, and we still don't have a diagnosis, and we don't know when he's going to wake up. So we just want to emphasize on the drug interactions. That's all, sir.
Thank you,
sir.
Any other comments or questions to Karthik or Shreya?
Thank you.
Okay, thank you very much. We will move on. The next patient is from Medicine Unit.